Hey everybody, thank you for choosing to hang out with me again. We're back with another serial killer file, and as always, they tend to be unsettling. This week we are discussing Robert Joe Long, also known as Bobby, who was also known as the classified ads rapist. Bobby started out by scouring the papers for his victims under the guise of purchasing whatever they were selling. He soon upgraded from serial rapist to killer once he could no longer satisfy his urges. I invite you to join me as we journey into the dark story of Bobby Joe Long. Sit back, relax, and let's dive in.
All the victims, all of them, you know, and you're talking about a lot of them, a lot of lives just gone right down the tubes because of me. You know, in one way or another. And it's not a good feeling. It's not a pleasant feeling. I'm not proud of anything I've done. And the worst thing is, I don't understand why.
Robert Joe Long was born on October 14th, 1953, in Canova, West Virginia, to his parents Lavella and Joe Long. Bobby was born with an extra X chromosome. This genetic disorder is known as Klinefelter syndrome. The presence of this extra chromosome caused his body to produce abnormal amounts of estrogen during puberty. This caused additional tissue to build up in his breast, making them larger than the other boys his age. His parents split when he was very young, and as a result, he and his mother moved to Tampa, Florida. The pair moved into a small one-bedroom apartment where they shared a bed until he was around 13 years old. Their relationship was very dysfunctional as Bobby began to resent his mother and her lifestyle. She worked as a bartender, so she spent many nights away, and when she would return home, she was hardly ever alone. He recounted how she dressed in racy clothing, and when she brought home strange men, she would entertain them in their shared bedroom with him present. He didn't like the way she carried herself or all of her short-term relationships. Bobby's home life and school life were not much different. He was often unhappy here due to the incessant bullying he received. His larger breasts attracted a lot of unwanted attention from classmates. As a result, he underwent breast reduction surgery to help curb the issues. During adolescence, he suffered a multitude of head injuries, with the first being at just 5 years old, when he was knocked unconscious when he fell from a swing. The following year, he was thrown from his bike. He crashed headfirst into a parked car. From this, he lost several teeth and suffered a concussion. At 7 years old, he fell off of a pony onto his head. From this injury, he suffered dizziness and nausea for weeks. His continuous head injury seemed to correlate with poor productivity in school since he failed the first grade. At the age of 13, he met Cynthia, who he dated for 6 years. After high school, he joined the Army, where he was stationed at Homestead Air Force Base. He and Cynthia were married by 1974. By the age of 20, he was settling into his role as husband and preparing for a family when he was involved in a serious motorcycle crash. The impact was so hard his helmet shattered and he was hospitalized for weeks. This latest injury brought about blinding headaches and random spurts of violent rage. After the accident, Cynthia states he became very short-tempered and it would later be reflected in the relationship. He also seemed to develop an overly high sex drive that he couldn't seem to control. Nothing was ever enough. After the incident, the couple did go on to have 2 children. His growing responsibilities of being a husband and father seemed to add to his volatility. Cindy eventually had enough of his outburst, and for her and her children's safety, she chose to leave. She filed for divorce in 1980. After the divorce, Bobby moved in with a female acquaintance named Sharon Richards. Rather than date around to satisfy his urges, he chose a much nastier approach. He began to scout out open house signs and classified ads selling furniture and other items. Anything to land him in an unsuspecting victim's home so he could force himself upon them. He started this spree from 1980 to 1983. Terrorizing Tampa and surrounding cities. He always attacked midday when their husbands would be at work. The MO was to produce a knife to instill fear. Then they were bound. Once incapacitated, he would sexually assault them before robbing them and fleeing the scene. It was estimated around 50 women were attacked. During this period, he also began to have legal issues. In 1981, Sharon Richards accused him of sexual assault, but due to lack of evidence, it allowed him to beat the charges. Then, in November of 1983, Bobby was caught sending obscene letters and pictures to a 12-year-old girl in Tampa. Phone calls were traced back to him, and he was arrested and charged for this. However, he only spent 2 days in jail and ultimately spent 6 months on probation. Despite all the horrific things he was doing behind the scenes, Bobby still wasn't satisfied. With all of his legal issues put to bed, he decides to up the ante by taking his first life. In March of 1984, artist Ann Wick was a young prostitute whose path unfortunately crossed Robert's. He was prowling for sexual satisfaction when he decided to cross the line. After sexually assaulting her, he strangled her to death. Her death marked the beginning of a 10-person killing spree over an 8-month period within 3 jurisdictions in the Tampa Bay area. The Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office, the FBI, Tampa Police Department, Pasco County Sheriff's Office, and Florida Department of Law Enforcement would all play a part in the capture of Bobby Long. His next killing took place in May of 1984 when he came across Wynn T. Long. She was 20 years old at the time and known to work as an exotic dancer. He offered to give her a ride and she accepted, but as soon as the car was moving, he pulled out a knife. She tried to fight and scream for help, but it was fruitless and he bound and gagged her. She was driven to a remote road where he followed the same fashion as his first victim. However, only 3 days later, her body would be discovered. Late in the afternoon, a pair of boys walking across a field in a remote area near I-75 in Hillsborough County noticed a pungent smell in the air. They decided to investigate, noticing the smell seemed to permeate from this blackened mound, which at first they thought was an animal. But upon further inspection, they realized they were staring at the remains of a nude woman. The boys ran for help and police arrived. Based on decomposition, the body had been there for at least 48 to 72 hours. They found rope tied around her neck, which had a leash-like extension. Her hands were left bound together behind her back, and she was left face down on the ground. Her legs were spread far apart, measuring close to 5 feet from one heel to the other. The body was deliberately displayed in this strange manner. Although personal items and clothing were not found, investigators were able to find hairs and a single red nylon fiber near the body. Tire impressions were also found near the roadway, but all 4 did not match and they were very worn out. They took photographs anyways. Robert claimed his next victim 2 weeks later. 22-year-old Michelle Sims was working as a prostitute at the time of her death. Long lured her back to his car where he assaulted her before slashing her throat repeatedly. She would be discovered roughly 8 to 10 hours after her death in an isolated area, much like his previous victim. She was found nude with her hands bound and a ligature around her neck. She had sustained blunt force trauma to her head. This time her clothing was left and more tire impressions had been discovered. The tire impressions this time were able to bring more information such as the make and what type of car they were typically used on. Due to the nature, it was immediately assumed this one was connected to the previous murder. More red nylon fiber was also discovered at the scene. By June, a third body had been found and police realized they had a serial killer on their hands. The body of 22-year-old Elizabeth Ludenbach was found in an orange grove in Hillsborough County. She was fully clothed unlike the others, but her body was in a very advanced state of decomposition. She had no ligatures present and was not found near the interstate like the other victims. So at first, this seemed completely unrelated to the previous victims. They even suspected her boyfriend of being guilty since he had failed a polygraph test. Elizabeth just didn't fit the MO. She was an assembly line worker with no previous convictions. But once investigators discovered similar hairs and more red nylon fiber, they had found victim number 3. The next body would not surface until October. The nude body of 18-year-old Chanel Devon Williams was discovered near Pasco Hillsbury County line. She was found next to the entrance of a dirt road near a cattle ranch. Her clothing was found next to her, while her bra was tied in a knot hanging from the entrance gate. Her head was more decomposed than the rest of her. This was due to a gunshot wound she had received on her neck. Chanel was reportedly working as a prostitute and was last seen weeks ago by one of her coworkers. At first, there was no apparent similarities until her clothing was sent off for testing. Once again, red fibers were found and similar hairs. Victim number 5 would be found in the same month. She was nude from the waist down in an unpopulated area near Hillsborough County. She was found 30 feet from the dirt road, and it appeared she had been dragged from the roadway. Again, she was too bound and had received blunt force trauma to her head and subsequently strangled to death. The victim would later be identified as Karen Beth Disfriend, a 28-year-old prostitute. The ligatures found convinced detectives the killer had developed a signature. The Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office assigned all of their homicide detectives to these cases. They created a surveillance team compiled of tactical detectives to do night watch in the area they considered the hunting grounds. The public was warned of the dangers lurking within the community and told to be vigilant. A few weeks after Chanel was recovered, the mummified remains of 22-year-old Kimberly Kyle Hopps were found near a highway. No clothing, ligatures, or physical evidence were found at the scene due to the amount of time the body had been exposed to the elements. Kimberly was only identified after Long had been arrested. November brought more bad news when more female remains were discovered, this time in Pasco County near Morris Bridge. Her bones were scattered about a large area and ligatures were still found attached to them. They also found her clothing and jewelry. Since they felt strongly that she was another victim, the agencies worked diligently to identify her. She was 18-year-old Virginia Lee Johnson, who split her time between Connecticut and Tampa working as a prostitute. By the end of November, the body count was up to 7 with the discovery of 21-year-old Kim Marie Swan, an exotic dancer. Her body was found on an incline of the road. She was at the scene less than 24 hours. Her clothes were found wadded up near the body, and she was face down with her head at the lower end of the incline. Faint tire impressions were discovered in the grass next to the roadway, indicating the killer had pulled off the road and thrown the body over the edge onto the incline. She displayed pronounced ligature marks. The victims were showing up in all different jurisdictions, so each chose to work their own cases, but continuing to work in conjunction with one another. The FBI became responsible for comparison of the various fibers found at each of the scenes, so all evidence was handed over. The open channel of communication allowed for the different departments to actively update with new information or victims. This open line of communication allowed for the other organizations to learn of the abduction of a 17-year-old girl in Tampa, which would ultimately lead to the biggest break in the case. On November 3, 1984, Lisa McVeigh was riding home on her bike after working a double shift at her job. Long grabbed her from a set of bushes and pressed a gun against her head, where he forced her into his car. Lisa was fearful for her life. She begged him to spare her, stating she would do anything. He demanded she get naked and perform oral on him before bounding and blindfolding her and driving off. He took her back to his apartment, where she was assaulted repeatedly for a period of 26 hours. Unlike his other victims, he chose to keep Lisa alive, and Lisa attributes this to her humane treatment of her captor. She spoke to him, even offering for him to be her boyfriend. She was fearful of how this was going to end. Lisa chose to leave as much evidence as she could, including her fingerprints, all over his apartment to prove she had been there. Once the news broke that she was missing, Long panicked and decided to let Lisa go. During this time, she took advantage of a little glimpses of her environment from under the blindfold. She took note of his red car with matching interior and that his dash had the word Magnum emblazed on it. She was able to provide some information about landmarks near his apartment and that he had withdrawn money from an ATM at around 3 a.m. All of this information was given to detectives through an extensive interview Lisa provided. Her clothing was also given, which produced red fibers. Her case was now linked to the rest, and detectives assembled a task force. The area was flooded with detectives searching for the apartment and the vehicle Lisa described. a 1978 Dodge Magnum. To narrow down the search, a list was produced which returned every registered Dodge Magnum in Hillsborough County. Detectives were assigned to various areas to search. One of these teams were in the known hunting grounds when they came upon a red Dodge Magnum. The vehicle was stopped under the guise of the officers looking for a robbery suspect. The driver was Robert Long. Police conducted a field interrogation report and took his photo before letting him go. During this same time, the records for the ATMs in the area were being subpoenaed. From this subpoena, police were able to connect Long to the transaction from the morning Lisa was released. With this information and his photo, they turned to Lisa for a positive identification. She successfully pulled his picture from a lineup, providing enough evidence for an arrest and search warrant to be drawn up. 36 hours after the task force was created, Long was arrested at a local movie theater. He was taken back to his apartment since the county prefers to have the owner present when conducting a search of the property. But Long refused to cooperate, so instead he was taken to the sheriff's office for interrogation. Initially, it was only about Lisa's case, to which Robert confessed, but as they began to shift to the homicides, he denied any involvement. By this point, his vehicle had already been seized and searched, with the carpet fibers being removed and examined to the known evidence. Once this was revealed and the significance of the other physical evidence comparisons to be done, Long folded, confessing to everything. He provided brief descriptions of each woman, even giving information about another victim, Vicki Elliott, who hadn't been discovered at this point. He explained how he chose random women and he was able to talk them into his car. He gained control of them with a knife or a gun. Once they were bound, he took them to various areas in order to assault them. He drew up a map showing them where to find one of his undiscovered victims, closing his total count to 10. All of his victims ranged from 18 to 28 years old, with majority being in sex work. He chose to strangle all but two of them. Robert Long received a plethora of charges, but ultimately pled guilty to all of them on September 24, 1985. He was sentenced to 26 life sentences, 4 99-year sentences, 1 5-year sentence, and 2 death sentences. He spent 3 decades on Florida's death row, where he attempted several appeals processes, but all were unsuccessful. On April 23, 2019, Governor Ron DeSantis signed off on his death warrant, making it his first one since taking office in January of the same year. More appeals were tried, but ultimately it was time for Long to face the consequences for his actions. On May 23, 2019, in front of the families and his surviving victim, Lisa, Robert Long was executed by lethal injection. He had his last meal at 9:30 in the morning, which consisted of roast beef, bacon, French fries, and a soda. He was pronounced dead by 6:55 p.m., and it went without incident. He kept his eyes closed through the entire process and had no last words. The families chose to address the media after. They expressed their gratitude to the governor and their joy to close this chapter in their lives. Lisa also spoke, and she has been very outspoken about her encounter, being the voice for those who no longer have one. She explains how she has forgiven Long because it allows her to be free. She also thanked him for taking her instead of another young girl, as she would never want someone else to endure what happened to her. Lisa states it helped shape her to who she is today, and she expressed sorrow for Long's family. Lisa has gone on to be a spokesperson for victims of similar circumstance in sharing her story. She even went on to join the Hillsborough County Sheriff's Department as a deputy in 1999. Lisa is now 54, happily married with a daughter who now has a child of her own. In 2018, a movie was created about her experiences titled, Believe Me, The Abduction of Lisa McVeigh. Wow, I really have to take a second and just clap for Lisa. I feel like it takes a big person to not only overcome what she did, but to also turn around and forgive them and offer your condolences to their family. I feel like that's just huge, especially considering the damage that Robert Long caused her. I don't know if I could personally do it. It's big to me. Also, how refreshing is it to have a situation where all the law enforcement parties involved came together, worked together, and closed out this case? Like, no issues with evidence, nothing slipped through the cracks. They had everything, they had it in place, and they were able to nail him. I mean, that's crazy. That never happens in these cases we discuss. But, as always, I'm interested to hear your thoughts. So leave them down below in the comments and we can chat. Also, if you found this to be informational, please consider giving it a thumbs up to let YouTube know you want more. And if you're not subscribed yet, please consider doing so because we would love to have you under the ash tree. I didn't mention this in my last video, but guys, the channel is now over 15,000 and I'm still kind of in shock. I'm trying to find the time to put out an extra video as like a celebration, but between my everyday job and with my birthday coming up, I'm having a very hard time trying to get it all worked in. My upload schedule has been kind of wacky if you hadn't noticed, but I'm trying. Anywho, I want to thank you guys for choosing to hang out with me every week. You do not go unnoticed. Thank you for your love and support. As always, you're all the best, and I will see you in the next one. Bye, friends.